So how did you break through the clutter? I mean, was it purely on the force of your amazing content, or were there other things, networks that you drew on to rise to the top?
I mean, it took a while. Like I said, there were three web series that I created one in college, and I created a second one, and it was the third one that hit, so it was constantly learning from my mistakes and using, again, what I wasn't seeing at the time, and it ended up being, you know, in preparation meets opportunity. I was ready to showcase this. I'd done all the work, and by the time I put it out there, people were ready to see it and ready to receive it, and they spread the word about it, and they... You know, in the same way that I'm sure your movement caught on, and people were ready. It was time. It was time for something new, and that was extremely helpful. I think that there weren't that many web series of color on the web at the time either, and people took it and ran with it.
I wanted to, Patrisse, touch on something that you referenced. You talked a little bit about the intersectionality of Black Lives Matter and today's movement, and it's definitely something that has struck me that today's movements of millennials are the connections between the queer movement and the immigrant rights movement and the, you know, Black civil rights movements and criminal justice reform are the silos that used to exist are really breaking down. And as you know, some of the most dynamic leaders are themselves women of color and queer, often also immigrants. And so I wonder if you could talk a little bit about that, how you see that playing out. I know that, or at least the version of the Netroots Nation story that I read, you know, suggested that it actually was an intervention hatched in conversation with immigrant rights leaders, and maybe you could share a bit about that.
Yeah, well, first off, Black folks are everything. We are not one type of being. And so we have James Baldwin, we have Audre Lorde, we have Bayard Rustin. We have a crew of Black folks who have been a part of this movement, and it's more about what we've decided in this era to lift up, and what we've decided that we're not going to be erased from this conversation. And so I say that because it's just, I think it's really crucial that people understand, both Black folks, but also our allies, understand that Black, it encompasses everything, that Black queer folks, trans folks, Black folks who are formerly incarcerated, Black folks who are currently incarcerated, Black folks who are disabled, Black immigrants, we exist in it all. And I think, you know, one of the big things that I realized in this work is that no species segregates itself. That's actually counterproductive. It's counter to evolution. And so in order for us to win, we have to bring all Black people together. That has to be crucial in how we do this work. It's about survival, literally. And so I'll talk about the Netroots Nation action. Sandra Bland had just been murdered a couple days before Netroots Nation, which is a larger part of sort of gathering progressives. And many of us had been there, attended for the first time. And it was called a dinner for Black folks and allies to come together. And I didn't know that there was going to be a presidential forum. It was my first time there, and we said we were going to disrupt it. And the point of the action was to talk about the state of emergency that Black America was in, and that no presidential candidate should be able to talk about their agenda without talking about Black people and without centering us. And so it was an action led by mostly women, and we did the If I Die in Police Custody sort of chant, which is something that came out of social media, which was a bunch of folks saying, hashtag If I Die in Police Custody, know that I did not commit suicide. Know that I was most likely killed. Make sure, you know, we just sort of said the things, and it was a heartbreaking hashtag, but it was also this moment of like, this is the moment we're in. This is the moment we're in where people have to say and tell other people and have witnesses, if I die in police custody, this is what you must do. And so we yelled that chant out, and it was very, you know, it was a designed action, and we disrupted the forum. And Tia Oso, who was a leader of the immigrant rights movement, she spoke about what it meant to be in Arizona and what it meant to sort of have this conference here. And then, you know, the rest is history. I didn't realize the media was going to take what it did with it, and I'm grateful for it. And now we've seen many candidates be disrupted since, and we've seen the conversation change.
Different kind of question for Issa and Danny, which short answer to, should we give up on Hollywood? So, you know, as you mentioned, there is now this season will be particularly diverse on television, at least folks in front of the camera, though probably not behind. And you know, as we know, that doesn't always translate to the kinds of depictions or storytelling that we would like to see in any event. And in some cases, it definitely doesn't. Some of the ones I've seen. And you know, we had the Opportunity Agenda did a study about 3 years ago on media depictions of black folks. In this instance, it was African American men. Results won't surprise any of you, and some of you were at the event in which we released the results. We are overly associated in all forms of media with poverty, with violence, with crime, far out of proportion to police records and reality. We know, I mean, my kids and I have a running joke, which is also a running tragedy, about the sassy black woman breaking chairs on television, and every time one comes on, which is constantly, we all roll our eyes and look at each other, but that's not so that we don't end up crying. I wonder, should we be fatalistic about Hollywood and mainstream entertainment, or should we think that actually those forms can't survive in an increasingly diverse America unless they change? Danny, maybe you could start.
No, we should not. We will not. If it's a venue, at least possibly we can tell our story. Then we find the story to tell. Yeah. I mean, I remember seeing Santa Fe Trail years ago. And it ended up hanging John Brown. This is a very curious way as a kid to see this. So I wanted to know who John Brown was, you know. Why is the only place that there's an avenue, a place named after John Brown, is Port-au-Prince, Haiti. The only place in the world is a monument for John Brown right here. So we get to find ways to do it. We develop a script on John Brown. There are five black men who were at Harper's Ferry, including one of them, Sheridan Leary, who was Langston Hughes' maternal grandmother's first husband. Not his father, his first husband. One of Langston Hughes' most prized possession was a bullet little shawl that he wore at Harper's Ferry. We do a story on that. Find out what are the dynamics and understand a little bit about that. No. And we'll find it. I'm going to go to A&E. I'm going to go to HBO. I'm going to go to everybody else because the story itself is compelling itself. It gives us another dynamic of a moment and a period and a reaction and a rebellion because most people consider the Harper's Ferry event is the straw that broke the camel's back to lead to the Civil War. You know. But all the dynamics around it, no. If it's a venue, look at it. Take it. Take control of it. Use our own imagination. Using imagination. But Einstein said imagination is more important than knowledge. You know. Use our own imagination to figure out how we can create a narrative that constitutes the values that are important for us. That are necessary for us. I remember when we did Buffalo Soldier. I wanted to do a story about Buffalo Soldier. So we did all the things we did. We tried to get an HBO. We couldn't get the writer to write. Then we found a writer and wrote his story. And every single thing in the story, we came up from our own imagination. This is the relationship. This is their gate by responsibility. This is how they went. These are what I call emotional danger. Not particularly the physical danger, the emotional danger that happens in this situation. We produced the film. It's exactly what we wanted to do it. Direct the film. I get the call from a great-great-great-granddaughter of Apache Chief. Said, that's the story we heard around our campfire. That children go, come on. In a sense, because it was the value of the relationships that we wanted to alter, the narrative that we wanted to create, made possible. I talked to with the assistant in California State Assembly. I'm trying to think about launching her name. She was president of San Luis State Assembly. She's now in Congress.
Karen Bass.
I was at her. I was at in her office one day in Sacramento. She said, "Thank you for Buffalo Soldier. We use Buffalo Soldiers as media, as mediating conflict in our school when I was in high school." So there's value there in our imagination. So where do we take this? They're the old stories, the new stories. We have a film, my company, Lubature Film, that is going to open at the Toronto Film Festival. This changes everything. Naomi Klein's book on climate change and global warming. This pins it right on capitalism. And what she does, she goes around the world and she looks at all what women are doing primarily women, who are changing the narrative around their communities and combating climate change, whether it's in China, whether it's in India, whether it's in Latin America, all those kind of stories within our realm, whether it's in Africa, women of color who are changing this narrative and moving forward in terms of climate change. So those are the kind of ways, but no, don't let it. Let's push it out there. You have to continue to push it out there. But I think it's important. What do we want to say? What is this narrative? We've gone through a struggle, and I'm a child of the civil rights movement. You know, I basically came through that San Francisco all my life, primarily. Came through all that San Francisco State, all that, all the period. Like, I was a child of all of that. We're going through those moments. Where can we find, in those particular moments, something that we can build on as we move towards the future with Black Lives Matter, with all the very emerging dynamics? How can we work with young people now and that is new and understanding this? We were all, it was Harry, Mr. B, and we were with Bo Taylor and Fred Williamson back in 1993. After the revolt in Watts, talking about mass incarceration, maintaining the peace between the Bloods and the Crips. Remember the Bloods and the Crips thing? Visiting with Nani Alejandros, who said, "This is my brother from Barrio Chinitos." Finding ways with and working with them. These are the kind of things I think that has to inform our work. And if we're going to have to push this through. And it's going to be pushed. I mean, there are going to be a lot of ways in which, and we've seen that right now, there are a lot of television shows that really mask the reality, that present us with this kind of pseudo-image of who we are. And you wait tonight. Every politician has on his lips mass incarceration.
Right.
So all the politicians, everybody's lining up the NGO, they're lining up there, and what's going to figure out how they're going to deal with it. How they're going to get some of the money that's going to come through that. And how it's going to be co-opted in the process as well. And the real changes that need to happen don't happen. You know what I'm saying?
I'm of two minds. You know, I'm not up here because of Hollywood. You know, I came through the internet, but I was inspired by a period. And, you know, it's not our business at the end of the day, but it is a business. It's driven by money. And so I don't want to give up on it at all. I think that there's so much work to be done. I think that, you know, a friend and I were talking about Straight Outta Compton this weekend, which made over $50 million, a huge record breaker, and about, you know, how we were conflicted initially before we found out the numbers just about seeing it. You know, on one hand, there are three black men, successful black men behind it, Will Packer, Tim Story, and Dr. Joe was a part of it as well. But it's also talking about an era in which black women were hated, and you know, it was sort of the genesis of hatred towards black women and violence towards black women. And there's something about that that's disgusting, you know, at the end of the day, and that shouldn't be celebrated. And so, on that same topic, she was talking about her 11-year-old cousin and how she was watching him watch Boys in the Hood, which came out in like 92, 94. And anyway, she watched him, you know, watch the movie and come to this one point where after they killed Ricky, spoiler alert, he died. he started cheering when, you know, the gangsters went to go back and get retribution and kill, you know, whoever killed Ricky, and just was giving this joy, like, yeah. And she was just like, what else is he gonna do? Like, what else? That's the, those are the images that are present for him to do. That those are his heroes at this point. But what is the alternative? And again, it goes to that question of, you know, who's telling our stories? What are we creating? And having a desire to spearhead new heroes, to give young Black men and young Black women new heroes. So we're doing it outside of the system, but again, Hollywood needs to catch on, and I think Hollywood is greatly influenced by the internet at this point, because you have so many vocal people at this point in time saying what they want to see and saying what they're tired of seeing and promoting what it is that they want to see at the end, and that to them translates as dollars. And again, that's what motivates them at the end of the day, is it going to make money? So I'm sure Straight Outta Compton will encourage more films of color to even travel overseas, because that's a myth as well, that Black films just don't sell overseas. And this film will prove them wrong, but will it spur more of the same, or will we have more opportunities? So I'm still with two minds.
Okay. Well, I want to ask one more question, and then I want to give you all a chance in case you want to ask each other some questions, and then I want to make sure we turn to the audience, and we have two microphones set up using the stand. Is what's the story that we should be telling? What are the values and the themes and the narratives that we should be getting out there through Hollywood, but also through the media that we have greater access to? And Patrisse, I know you're not in Hollywood, but you are an artist as well as an activist, and I just want to start with you and see if you have some thoughts on that.
Yeah. I do performance art. I've been an artist since I was a small child, but one of my latest pieces is called Power from the Mouths of the Occupied, and it brings Black folk stories of state violence to stage. I think Black folks being able to tell our stories exactly how we live them is necessary. With all of the joys and the flaws and the hurts and the pain, and I think specifically telling stories that tie our history here in this country in particular together. And so I decided to do this play when I was doing an artist residency last year, because I knew of everything I grew up watching and witnessing around law enforcement. And I also knew how much we didn't talk about it. Like, after our home was raided, it wasn't like my mom sat us down to have a conversation about the impact that had on us. It was like, well, she gotta go to work tomorrow, and I gotta make sure the kids are fed. So what happens to Black children when these are the images, the things we see, and we don't actually have space to process or talk about it? And then it's happening in an entire community, and we're not actually having real life conversations or dealing with the consistent trauma. And so Power from the Mouths of the Occupied has Black folks literally sharing their story, and it's in monologue form. And what for me was most profound was that every single Black person had a story. Had a story, whether it was them that experienced law enforcement violence themselves or being bearing witness. And if people know about trauma, sometimes they say secondary trauma, the thing that you witness is harder on the person than the person who experienced the trauma itself. And so I think there's value for me and Black folks telling the pains that we face, because we oftentimes have to either deny it, we don't get to express it, or we have to repress it. And so there's something cathartic about being honest and bringing our stories to stage in an honest and I think focused way. So that for me feels most valuable.
Danny, good. Thoughts on the stories we should be getting out?
I couldn't add anything to what my sister said. I as I listen to her, and I think as we all listen to us, there's a yearning for us to hear those kind of stories and to feel those kind of stories, because they're stories that we're all connected to. And so I don't know how I could even add to that. To what your brilliant response was, you know? It touched me in the sense of thinking beyond, because a great deal a great deal. I'm a quasi, I call myself a quasi historian. So, and how history has always been one of my great passions, movements and everything else. And how you define it and look at stories from a vantage point and creating another way, another entree into the story. Those certainly, I think, the challenges of individuals within the context of the community and the structures that they're opposed to. So with all that interesting. So all those are the kind of stories that we find in there. The idea of me, I remember we did a play, we tried to do something for Showtime with it about the relationship between this African-American man and Japanese woman who'd been married for 30 years. And try to find that Yohan, written by Philip Katanga, a Japanese-American playwright. And I saw it about the intersection. So those are kind of, I gravitate, where do we find the intersection? I remember when I had a relationship with Disney, I said, let me do a vacation. Basically, film like Chevy Chase, where instead of going to, instead of leaving South Central LA, we go to my relatives who are Comanche, you know what I'm saying, on the reservation. I said, well, God, that's a great idea. It'll be fun and everything. My grandmother's part Choctaw, you know what I'm saying? So that connects us to find different ways in which we can explore our reality through those other relationships, you know. I mean, when we did Buffalo Soldier, I wanted a black Seminole Indian in it, John Horse, because people don't know about the relationship that black Seminole Indians had in Florida in the three Seminole Indian Wars, you know, in which the U.S. couldn't defend them, with Andrew Jackson, Zachary Taylor, and Colonel Dale became counselors. So all those kind of stories that find where we find connections and marry those relationships, where we find other bonds, you know. Those are the kind of stories that draw me, you know, and everyone's known up and trying to do, you know, my seminal piece is the Haitian Revolution and what it meant, you know. I mean, you know, the one voice that heard say, hey, let's do this, was Hugo Chavez. As soon as he put up some money, not all of them, I said, the president put up this amount. We spent all this in Venezuela. All the naysayers, all the haters begin to come in. Now nobody asks, why has this story been done? The question is, no, why has this story not been done? But everybody else came on and said that, you know. So and that's the way of thinking. But every single thing that we talk about, that we think about, that we feel, in a sense. So I want to go to here. What is the first step in our realization, imagination of myself? What do we feel? I said, God, I felt that. I remember seeing 12 years of play, 12 years of slave. I'm sitting there with the popcorn drops on the floor. I don't even pick it up. I'm so limited because something in my own psychic history, something in my historic memory comes alive. You know that? And I said, where is that? It's painful. You know, and it's all that, because the healing comes through going through the pain. That's right.
Definitely all of that, and then some. I want everything. You know, I think I understand the importance of slave narratives, but I want to see stuff before that. I know that we come from an extremely rich history, and I'm kind of tired of stories where we're constantly trampled upon, and I want to see historical narratives, say in Africa. I want to see it, you know, Native American stories. I want to see black people in the future, you know. So we have a lot of science fiction films in which we're nowhere in sight, so we don't escape there. Which is actually very frightening. I want to see all the stories. I mean, again,
this part Choctaw, you know what I'm saying? So that connects us to find different ways in which we can explore our reality through those other relationships, you know. I mean, when we did Buffalo Soldier, I wanted a black Seminole Indian in it, John Horse, because people don't know about the relationship that black Seminole Indians had in Florida in the three Seminole Indian Wars, you know, in which the U.S. couldn't defend them, with Andrew Jackson, Zachary Taylor, and Colonel Dade, the King Council. So all those kind of stories that find where we find connections and marry those relationships, where we find other bonds, you know. Those are the kind of stories that draw me, you know, and everyone's known up and trying to do, you know, my seminal piece is the Haitian Revolution and what it meant, you know. I mean, you know, the one voice that heard say, hey, let's do this, was Hugo Chavez. As soon as he put up some money, not all of them, I said, the president put up this mountain. We spent all this in Venezuela. All the naysayers, all the haters begin to come in. Now nobody asks, why has this story been done? The question is, no, why has this story not been done? But everybody else came on and said that, you know. So, and that's the way of thinking about every single thing that we talk about, that we think about, that we feel, in a sense. So I want to go to here. What is the first step in our realization, imagination about self? What do we feel? I said, God, I felt that. I felt that. I remember seeing 12 years of play, 12 years of slave. I'm sitting there with the popcorn. The popcorn drops on the floor. I don't even pick it up. I'm so limited because something in my own psychic history, something in my historic memory comes alive and everything else. You know that? And I said, where is that? It's painful. It's painful. It's painful. You know, and it's all that because the healing comes through going through the pain.
Definitely all of that, and then some. I want everything. You know, I think I understand the importance of slave narratives, but I want to see stuff before that. I know that we come from an extremely rich history, and I'm kind of tired of stories where we're constantly trampled upon, and I want to see. I want to see historical narratives set in Africa. I want to see it, you know, Native American stories. I want to see black people in the future, you know. So we have a lot of science fiction films in which we're nowhere in sight, so we don't escape from it, which is actually very frightening. I want to see all the stories. I think, again, where we're constantly, we always have limitations placed upon us, and I think that needs to cease. And we have so many rich stories to tell. We're capable. And it's just a matter of finding those stories and putting them out and supporting them.
Every time I see this movie, in the heat of the night, they call me Mr. Tears.
My body starts shaking.
They call me Mr. Tears. Every time I see that movie, I see that scene, my body starts.
I think about the future. I saw that we black folks have a presence on the poster for the new Star Wars film.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Yeah, let's hope we don't get killed off. We'll see. Well, so let me give you all a chance to ask each other some questions if you have them, and then I want to turn to the audience.
I want to know how Patrisse feels about about one, other people perhaps co-opting Black Lives Matter into other things, and I don't know if you've heard of the Say Her Name, Say Her Name.
Yes,
with Black Trans. Well, initially, the trans movement.
Yes.
Black trans women being killed by police and being killed in general. And then how you feel about all lives matter. Just to troll you.
I mean, you know, I'll start with all lives matter. I think when people use all lives matter, it's actually to erase and negate black folks. And I really think it's a reactionary response to the burgeoning black movement. And it's a fear response, and it's a knee-jerk reaction to not want to talk about what black people face. And so I always, and it's very often not black people who are saying all lives matter. The other thing I'll say about all lives matter, and I really appreciate this, you know, comic that came out, which was essentially two houses, one was burning and one was not, and it was someone watering a non-burning house saying, all houses matter. Even when we're in a state of emergency, we can't get the grace to be saved. And so I think it's important that we do not change the hashtag. I think it's important that other races, nationalities decide what the innovative hashtag is going to be for them, right? We're trying to archive. You know, a hashtag really archives. A hashtag allows something to go viral. So Black Lives Matter was about an intervention. We were trying to make an intervention in the assumption that we were in post-racial America after Trayvon Martin was murdered and George Zimmerman was acquitted. So I think Black Lives Matter is important, and we have to keep it as such. The other piece, though, about being co-opted, it's interesting, right? Because I just saw, and no judgment to the Bernie Sanders folks in the room, okay? We're not going after Bernie Sanders. We're going after a nation that has systematically killed black folks for the last hundreds of years. So it has nothing to do with Bernie. But I just saw someone from, you know, like a Bernie Sanders person post something, and he's black, and he wrote, I'm a part of the Black Lives Matter. I organize with Black Lives Matter, and I'm for Bernie Sanders. And it was this interesting moment where I was like, That's actually called co-optation. The sort of like need to utilize Black Lives Matter as a poster child or as a poster to advance someone else's agenda. That's not the point. It's not about advancing an individual's agenda. It's about advancing this country and arguably the world. So I just think that it's you know, it took a lot of work for the co-founders in particular to challenge lots of folks who were tripping on us very early on about Black Lives Matter. And us having, I mean, we're organizers, so we had our courageous conversations. We did, you know, unity struggle, unity with folks. We went online and called people out and, you know, and asked people to have conversations with us. And I think we've won the battle of ideas. And I think beyond winning the battle of ideas, we have to change this place that we live in. And I think Black Lives Matter is just, it's a gift, you know, it was a gift to the movement. I don't believe we started the movement. I don't believe we are even leading the movement. I think we're a part of hundreds of people across the country and across the world that are trying to change the day-to-day interactions that black people have to face are deadly interactions. I hope and pray that as we develop Black Lives Matter politically, people ride with us. And don't try to co-opt it, and actually try to advance a new narrative.
So I'm actually going to turn to the audience now, but in the course of the rest of our conversation, if you all have questions for each other, you should feel free to bring them.
So I want to know who is going to be the Black Advocate Lobby. So we talk
Black
about
Advocate.
Black Advocate Lobby, the lobby for us. So, for example, Jews in America, if you say something that's negative about Jews, all of a sudden you have a lobby. You have people that are coming against you, saying things and making sure that that doesn't happen again. Who's doing that for us? Who's making sure that we as a people are going to make sure that the things that are being said about us are going to be the things that are going to promote positive and enlightening and uplifting views of our culture?
Black Twitter is doing that, I think. Black Twitter will take you to task. They will dig up archives. They've already changed the narrative of so many stories. They get people filed. They'll find your social security and address. I've seen that happen. I think that's a force to be reckoned with, for sure.
And, you know, I would add that many of us in the social justice world and many of our organizations and some in the room here Certainly the opportunity agenda, color of change, Demos, and others are also on the job. What is different about 21st century movements is that they're not organized around the one charismatic leader. And they are networked, and they are much more horizontal. And so a lot of that work that gets done, and I don't think any of us would claim that we have it completely covered, but a lot of that work that gets done is less visible to the general public, but really makes a difference in terms of the public discourse. But for sure, more work to be done.
I echo your point that we certainly made this, leadership is not basically horizontal, but it's always been. We think about those really charismatic leaders that we've had. But underneath, there's been organizing through various areas of small towns. You talk to slick workers and talk about who were the workers, who were the people that they worked with in Mississippi. And when they were in Mississippi, they would say retired Pullman car. Who would retire and then come back there and help them organize and show them the way, show them where to do and what the various things. So I think that we've always had that horizontal place, and we always kind of wanted to be vertical. We want someone to step up. We wanted Martin to step up. We wanted Malcolm to step up. We want Jesse at times to step up. Whoever stepped up. But I think it's important, it's critical, that there becomes that consistency that is, and we have to celebrate that. We have to celebrate that and embrace that.
Okay, let's.
I just want to say one more thing, because I think it's actually really important to talk about Twitter and the role it's played, especially Black Twitter. Black Twitter we are here because Black Twitter has Black Twitter made Mike Brown go viral. Black Twitter made Ferguson go viral. It was not the news that made that. It was not mainstream media. It was, Black Twitter was making Mike Brown go viral 3 days before the media hit the ground. And so it's a force to be reckoned with, and it's really allowed our narratives to be named in a very particular way in this moment in history.
And the reading of Langston's poem, Kids Who Die, that's already had a million hits.
Yep.
It's already had a million. There's a poem to that, it's incredible. And everyone I've sent to it, what they've done is they put it on their Facebook. Or got it to their Twitter account.
Excellent. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Renee Buchanan, and my question is, there's power in numbers, and around the issue of Black Lives Matter, what do we do to mobilize more our church family, our church leaders? I know we have so many Black churches that can make a difference in this issue. This is a crisis that we have in this world today. And we all need to come together with that. We don't seem to be most mobilizing in that direction.
There are faith leaders that are rising to the occasion. Pastor McBride, who's out of Oakland, and there's Pastor Starsky, who's in St. Louis. But there is a schism inside the Black church around this current moment, and I think it's an important conversation to have. I don't know if this is a panel to have it, but I do think that it's going to take a significant amount of organizing to get the Black church on board, and oftentimes it takes some time, even during civil rights, right? MLK was an anomaly. It wasn't sort of like the whole of Black church was ready to get on board around fighting for civil rights. So I think that what we do need to do is lift up the leaders, the pastors who are doing that work. And oftentimes, like we see with most movements, then people will follow. But I agree with your point.
We can't afford to lose another life.
Did others want to talk to you? Okay, well, I did want to note that I think we are thankfully emerging from the era in which people believed that religious meant conservative. And that was never true. It was never fully accurate, but I think we're breaking out of that. One of our newest colleagues at the Opportunity Agenda is Dr. Overy Hendricks, who's here. Many of you know, who's our senior faith and opportunity fellow. He is really helping us to make sure that we are nurturing and strengthening those connections and telling a story that includes faith that is not exclusive to faith, but that includes faith in a really genuine way and helps to build those relationships. So I think this is a really important moment for that. And interestingly, again, one of the things we do is study public opinion. And millennial white Christian evangelicals are one of the groups that have increased the most in their concern about issues of poverty and inequality. Not always race, just something to work on. But we see that even some of those old stereotypical categories are no longer holding. Again, it's going to be up to us to tell an effective story and make sure that we bring folks along. We're going to go to this gentleman.
I'd like to ask you, if you're going to vote for Bernie Sanders, and if not, why not?
Yeah, the opportunity agenda is a 501c3, and we would like to preserve our tax status. It's very important to us. I will give you a chance, however, to reframe your question a different way if you would like to, but we will not be discussing the pros and cons of any political candidates. Okay, fair enough. We'll go.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Joyce Harley, and I was delighted to see the standing up and challenging Bernie Sanders. But what it does feel like and seem like, unless I missed it, is that Hillary Clinton has gotten a pass, and she too was unable and unwilling very early on to say that Black Lives Matter. So I'm not asking you to identify with respect to any particular candidate, but I'm asking, is there a commitment to making sure that everybody that's raised their hand and said they want to leave this nation understands that Black Lives Matter?
So it's great framing.
Yeah.
It's a commitment to holding every candidate.
Well, so I don't know if you've seen, I don't know if you read, but we did go and confront Hillary in New England. If you watch Melissa Harris Perry tonight, we'll be showing the exclusive video, and our folks will be talking about the interaction they had. We plan to shut her down, but Hillary has Secret Service. But what ended up happening was a confrontation, and a very important confrontation in which we didn't allow media to be let in, but we recorded it, and we are going to release it today. We also shut down Bush in Las Vegas. And we were going to with Trump, but he canceled his event in Iowa. But I think this is an important question. We believe in the act of disruption for every single candidate when it's timely and doing it safely for our people's safety in particular. No candidate will be immune from Black Lives Matter disruption.
Thank you so much.
I noticed a lot of people embrace the black mother who was beating her son down after Freddie Gray, beating him on his way home. And I think the issue of, I'm wondering what you think about the issue of punishment and discipline, and also people saying something like, well, Sandra Bland had her head in the lion's mouth. And my mama always told me that you take your head out of the mouth of the lion.
That image of the black mom, hitting her son. You know, what was interesting about how the media framed that was it had everything to do with his safety. You could tell how scared she was for him. They interviewed her afterwards, of course, but it was less about her trying to deter him from being on the streets and more about her not wanting him to be murdered by police. And that wasn't the narrative being told. And so that, to me, was most disturbing about that. Her reaction, we can have a whole conversation about hitting the children, but more for me was about she was scared. She was genuinely scared for her child's safety because of law enforcement. And none of the media did that, right? They praised her for taking her son out the streets. And with Sandra Bland, she did not deserve to die. Point blank. She did not deserve to be pulled over. Let's start there. And because she named and was clear about her rights, she was pulled out of that car and she was killed in that jail cell. And that's the narrative. Less about, you know, she should have, you know, been quiet and did whatever. No, cops should not feel like they should kill us. That should be the conversation.
Just to add the point about the mother beating her son, you know, I agree completely with Patrisse, and I think the implicit narrative there is one we see all the time, which is that injustice is really about personal responsibility.
Right.
And that young black men need to be beaten by their parents, and then they wouldn't act up. It used to be called knowing your place. And so and when it was clear to those of us who fear for our children's safety that that was what she was concerned about, and I completely agree that that was not the narrative. So the act needs to be separated from the media narrative, which I found to be very troubling. Okay, who's next? Yes, Akichi.
I'm Nikichi. Thank you for all that you have done on the panel. One of the stories that we should be telling today, August 17th, is the birth date of Marcus Garvey. He has all been obliterated from history. We had 12 years a slave, but I've never seen a Hollywood picture on Harriet Tubman. I feel that we need stories of resistance, and my question then goes to Danny Glover, because I know you've been studying the Haitian Revolution. I know you've been working on a film dealing with Toussaint Louverture. I want to know just where is that? Is it going to happen? Is it going to come out? Because of no other personage whose name has been obliterated, he is the one who really led the first and only successful black revolution in the Western Hemisphere. So, what's happening with Toussaint?
Don't put me on the
spot. No, she should have, you know, been quiet and did whatever. No, cops should not feel like they should kill us. That should be the conversation.
Just to add the point about the mother beating her son, you know, I agree completely with Patrisse, and I think the implicit narrative there is one we see all the time, which is that injustice is really about personal responsibility.
Right.
And that young black men need to be beaten by their parents, and then they wouldn't act up. It used to be called knowing your place. And so and when it was clear to those of us who fear for our children's safety that that was what she was concerned about, and I completely agree that that was not the narrative. So the act needs to be separated from the media narrative, which I found to be very troubling. Okay, who's next? Yes, Nikichi.
I'm Nikichi. Thank you for all that you have done on the panel. One of the stories that we should be telling today, August 17th, is the birth date of Marcus Garvey. He has all been obliterated from history. We had 12 years a slave, but I've never seen a Hollywood picture on Harriet Tubman. I feel that we need stories of resistance, and my question then goes to Danny Glover, because I know you've been studying the Haitian Revolution. I know you've been working on a film dealing with Toussaint Louverture. I want to know just where is that? Is it going to happen? Is it going to come out? Because of no other personage whose name has been obliterated, he is the one who really led the first and only successful black revolution in the Western Hemisphere. So, what's happening with Toussaint?
Don't put me on the spot. I think it's going to be done. I know it's going to be done. And certainly, you know, it's not always done when you want it to be done, but it's going to get done. You know, I think there's a consensus that is an important story. It gives us another picture of a period in time where a slave rebellion challenged the empire and the emerging system of economics, capitalism, at a time, and I think it's going to be done. And so it's part of it's there. I can't tell you when. In fact, I stopped talking about it because sometimes what happens is that we did, we were here, I was in Boston, and with Brother Gates here, we were doing a program on the Emancipation Proclamation, and had a little Haitian American girl tell the story that she wanted to reference, they wanted her to reference Frederick Douglass, or one of the reference John Brown. She says, I want to reference that Toussaint Louverture is a part of that, and understanding that the history and everything that led up to the Emancipation Proclamation is in part a result of that slave rebellion is always. And it was very interesting looking from that vantage point, because every single abolitionist spoke about the Haitian Revolution. In fact, Frederick Douglass always referred to himself as a Haitian at heart. You know, it's going to be done. I just want to reference that. I mean, I think about this moment, and I was having a conversation with Jack O'Dell, who was a confidant in very close moments, a socialist with Martin Luther King, and he talked about this, you know, his speech on Beyond Vietnam. That's been a silent speech. Nobody refers to that speech at all, Beyond Vietnam. But most of us acknowledge to some extent it was perhaps the speech that got him killed. The speech that was like, when he talked about war, racism, and materialism, militarism, I think we have to reference what is happening within our community, within that context. When he talked about war, certainly if he was able to look at be with us at this moment, certainly the things that people would reference is what is happening in our community. In fact, it wasn't that King that went to Newark. He was in Watts. He was in every place at the moment of a revolt and everything else like that. So I think it's in a moment for us to capture this moment, to really for African Americans particularly, to acknowledge the importance of that speech in relationship to what is happening, not only internationally, but within our communities itself. And I think it's the challenge. Now that's going to cause another kind of discussion among us. You know, that's going to be a discussion that probably King had when he told Whitney Young, you may get a government grant for not opposing the war in Vietnam, but you won't get the keys to the kingdom of heaven. You know, when he saw that, which, but at what point is that we have to have that kind of discussion within us? When we talk about policy, we can't just talk about policy among ourselves. We have to understand how those policies, first of all, resonate someplace else before they get here. Or they happen simultaneously while they're here. But we have to understand that. We have to be, and I think that's one of my hopes in terms of as Black Lives Matter, as the Dream Defenders, Check Color Change, all the groups that come out of this from the bottom up, because these are groups from the bottom up, that they begin to kind of like use that as a clarion call, not only for what is happening in our communities, what it happens in communities around the world as well.
And on that speech, I do want to recommend to folks the documentary Citizen King by Orlando Bagwell, which is focuses on the speech, is extremely powerful. I think it's available on Netflix.
Yeah. I give a bit of trivia for the young woman. Viola Davis is producing a Harriet Tubman movie. Oh. Sorry.
Fantastic. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Barbara Brook, and I'd like to say it's a true privilege to be here. My question is two-pronged. I want to know how someone like me, I'm about to turn 64, can help promote your message, can be an advocate for Black Lives Matter and for changing your narrative. And the other thing is it, I know this may sound naive, but is it harmful or helpful for me to think and for hopefully to get other people to think in terms of when we see these children, Tamar Rice, who's I'm from Cleveland, Michael Brown, all the names that have been mentioned today.
Tamir Rice,
yeah. He's a Clevelander. Is it...
Was,
right. Is it helpful for us to think of them as these are our children, our future. We can't afford to lose anyone, and no one should worry about when their child goes out the door that they might not come home.
Yes.
Is that helpful or is that offensive?
It is immensely helpful. we can't, none of us, yeah, I'm 69, okay, and we have to keep talking. Wherever you can talk, wherever you can understand and have that understanding reflect in your own narrative, in their own conversation, wherever you can, you have to be open to this. You know, we all have to be open. I can't reside in 1975 or 19. I'm here right this moment. The dynamics, the dialects, the contradiction have changed from that particular point in time and everything else. So we all are learning and growing. We're learning and growing. I'm learning. You're learning. If you choose to learn, if you choose to grow, that's what it's about.
Yeah, I think everyone. I say this a lot. I think it's all hands on deck right now. Folks are dying. Black people are dying every single day, and that's just one part of the misery. There's so much more that's happening to black folks. There's 1 million of us sitting inside U.S. jails and prisons. So I think it is about all hands on deck and figuring out which ways, the best ways to participate. And every location, every city, every neighborhood is different. In Los Angeles, we have a group called, we call it Solidarity as a Verb. And we have allies that meet weekly and think about the ways that they're going to relate to this Black Lives Matter movement. And it's powerful. We've seen such powerful actions and responses and conversations from allies showing up in this moment. So I'd love to discuss that with you after the panel. And then the other piece around, is it helpful or harmful? I think we should think about, we all should be thinking about each other's children as our children, right?
Yes.
That's very African. Someone else's child. The child is our child. So I think that's exactly how people should be thinking about black children, because the reality is black children don't get to be children. We don't get to be a child. And so to humanize us and to believe that our childhood is worthy is necessary and important. And to, you know, sit down with your friends and make sure they believe that too.
Patty Rice, who had an event together in Los Angeles, and she pulled out a paper where she had the sheriff at the beach with a bunch of black kids. She pulled out this paper, a group of black kids, getting at the beach, playing in it. And she looked and said, "You it." And she couldn't believe it was him. It was the sheriff who had arrested some of their mamas and daddies. He was at the beach. He just went over and took them all to the beach. And she said, and she's going through some training with the LA Police Department. This is really kind of right something up. But she said, "You gotta love our children." That's what she said, "You gotta love our children." It's as simple as that. Basically, you say it, you connect to that. After all the history and all the history you know about, all the history that you encounter, you gotta love our children. And Patrice said, you know, they're all our children. They're all our children.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Vanessa Cooksey, and I have a concern around the lack of diversity on the technical side of media production, lighting, sound, post-production. Are you aware of any programs that are helping, you know, to encourage more diverse talent, not just in writing and directing, but the technical side of production?
I mean, that's an issue I'm facing even now. You know, I'm shooting a pilot in September, and that's something that's really important to me. You know, I've done independent projects in that past. The crews are extremely diverse, but I've found that, you know, within the network system, they hire who they know, and a lot of who they know are just a bunch of white guys, and it's also unionized, so if you're not part of the union, you won't get hired, and it's, like, extremely important to me to be able to, you know, find those, dig through the trenches and find the lighting people, find the first ADs and second ADs that are of color so that I can get a chance to work on this spot and get the experience and continue to work. There will be no excuse after that. As far as programs, I know that I get to talk to me afterwards. There are a couple that I have actually reached out to, but I have to look through my emails. But there are definitely some in LA. I don't know where you can go.
You know, I'm starting a film tomorrow, but actually Wednesday in San Francisco. And It's one of those stories. I think the writer and director came to me about 4 years ago. And it really is the relationship this man is going through, and the relationships and a new family that he's found. This man who is HIV/AIDS. And as he tries to keep his meds up, and the relationships and the family that builds out around that, you know, myself, my wife, and others who build around that relationship. 4 years. When I told him 4 years around, he said, "We don't have no money." And I said, "When you come back, I want to do the project. We get some money." He came back 4 years later, "We still don't have no money." Those are the stories that don't get told, right? They don't get told, this relationship. Is it because, and if it, you know, maybe, I don't know, fittingly or whatever, it's in San Francisco. You know what I'm saying? But it's such a compelling story about relationships, family, building, struggling, and fighting through, all of them, falling through their personal relationships. It's one of those kind of stories. But you can't get it. You can't, you know, there's no money to pay the actors, and there's very little money to do the film. And that's the way this business has. If it's not a graphic novel, it's not something where you're playing the Incredible Hulk or something else, or Spider-Man sidekick or whatever it is, there's no value in the process. But you got to keep going, and you have to do it, because it's important those films are done. And they have to keep doing those films. I mean, we made To Sleep With Anger with $1 million.
Wow.
Back then. I mean, we probably wouldn't have been able to get it made with $1 million now. Or give us $1 million to try to make it, you know.
Turn to this gentleman.
Hello, my name is Richard Reed. Hey, Ricky. As a person who wants to go into the entertainment business, not because of fame, but because I make a difference, because growing up, I never seen people of color like me, you know, doing anything. And as I see my mom who beat me on a regular when I got online, I wanted to know, what is your advice for someone like you, me, and people in general, of youth who want to see our young kids generation change and who just want to see a difference? What is your advice to people like me who want to make a difference? Because I know that what you said was like basically love is something that our youth definitely needs, and in my opinion, discipline as well. But what is the other advice that you would give people like me, or youth who's like 23, I'm 23, and other people in this room who are younger and are older? How are we supposed to tackle this? Because it's getting worse, and it's sad to see people like me. When I look around, I have yet to have a friend of color who's my age. All my best friends have all been Caucasian, and I would like to see more people like me succeed in life instead of having a...
Make something. Honestly, make something. Collaborate with your friends, whether they're Caucasian or not, and create what you want to see. Like, that's it at the end of the day. You have all the tools. You have a phone?
Yes.
You can make it. So many episodes of television out of my iPhone, entire feature films. It's literally just, it's in your hands at the end of the day. Now, there's literally no excuse. You love it, you're passionate about it, do it. That's it.
I also wanted to add a resource. One of the Opportunity Agenda's Facebook networks is called Creative Change, and it is exclusively folks who are engaged in or passionate about arts, culture, and social change. And some are filmmakers, and some are spoken word artists, and you know, some are graphic artists. There's a wide range of folks. So definitely get on there, and you know, it's a way of interacting with other people who share your interests. And it's a very diverse network of some really fantastic folks.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon, Linda D. Gaines. Thank you so much for coming to our island and dragging yourself away from Los Angeles. My question is, I'm sorry the other young lady isn't there as well, but my question is about co-opted households. I feel like I'm doing all I can as a mother, as an auntie, to be socially conscious and also teach the next generation to do so as well. But It saddens me when I come through a household of family members and I do see them changing the channel and putting on some of those chair-throwing episodes and that reality TV. And since we've taught young persons to parse and look at all types of media and format and let it, and it's wafting in, it is having damage, but it's difficult for someone as an adult to come in and say, you know, you shouldn't be watching that, or there are other choices, or maybe there aren't so many other choices. What would you say about that advice?
Well, first of all, there's a history of, you know, the older generation being worried about the younger generation. That's just going to happen. You know, you're always going to worry about what they're going to grow up to be. And I think part of it is trusting them to grow up and be great. And the other part is, I think that you do have to show them other options. And that's the problem now. You have to constantly present them with, and then search for and research other things that they could possibly like and place it in front of them. Try to be as involved as you can. I know that. I think about frequently how when I have kids and I grow older, our oldies are going to be like, juvenile, back that ass up. And I'm going to be like, oh, yeah, this is my song. Yeah. I used to back up too. But I mean, that's, you know, but I know I'll be fine. You know what I mean? Okay. I'm scared about what they're going to be listening to when I'm older as well. But, it's all in the parenting. It's all who you surround them with. It's all in their friendships. And I think that's the most, that's all you can do.
Thank you.
Yeah, as a parent, I would say, I would add that, when I encounter my kids, you know, watching or consuming media that I think is jacked up, I make it either a conversation or an excruciating lecture that is like so painful that they will not ever want to do it again. Now, the problem, of course, is that they can consume media constantly and through a variety of methods that have nothing to do with me. I can't control that, and I guess that's where the trust part has to come in. But, you know, we talk about it all the time, and just when I think that I'm having no effect, actually, I notice the eye contact or the, you know, knowing glance that tells me that that I'm rubbing off in some ways. So, I think that's the best we can do.
I'm laughing because I'm working on my 12-year-old grandson. So I can pass the parenting. I'm extended parenting in a sense, but yeah. And I really know that sometimes it's, and I watch him on his little phone. He's been sitting next to me, and he's on his doing something, playing some game, something. I said, Are they sure? How about us having a conversation? It's for a moment, you know, we can have a comment. What are you thinking? What are you feeling? Or something like that. But it's a challenge, you know what I'm saying? But all the ways in which they information or different other things that you have no control over become a part of their life and what they do, it's a challenge.
Well, I will continue to keep hope alive in my co-opted household.
It's very painful to me. It breaks my heart every time I turn on the television and see another dead body, a young black person killed by a policeman. But there's something that bothers me even more. I'm from Baltimore, Maryland. In May of this year, we had 45 dead bodies of young black males on our streets. Not one of them was killed by a white policeman. My question is, how do we stop the slaughter of our kids in the street by our kids?
I mean, I think one way is we change the conditions in which black folks live in. I grew up in I was raised poor and grew up in a super poor neighborhood and witnessed a lot of violence in my community. And I can tell you there was no youth center that we could go to. There was no space that my mother could make sure that we were at while she worked her three jobs. There was very little food in our home. And so the conditions that we live in create significant amount of trauma, and trauma recreates violence. And so how do we actually talk about those conditions? I think we can't divorce what happens inside poor black neighborhoods from what's happening in the White House or what's happening in local government, who's receiving resources and who's not. And larger part, in the last 30, 40 years, we've received very little to no resources, and in fact, our communities have been divested from. In Los Angeles, what used to be Central Ave 40, 50 years ago, a vibrant black community has been completely decimated. How do we have those conversations? How do we change our actual conditions in which we feel valued, we feel valuable, we look at each other and see each other's value? That feels important to me. I remember growing up and being like, this cannot be the way. This can't be how black folks live and exist. And that's why I joined this movement. I joined this movement at 16 because I knew that it had to be another way. And so I challenged myself and I challenged us in the room, how are we going to change the conditions for black people? We can't just blame us. We have to change things for us too.
We've heard the gentleman's concern on many occasions. And we've heard those concerns over a long period of time. I mentioned earlier the attempts by men who were ex-gang members or men who had been incarcerated to try to change the narrative, the nature of what happens in their community. And that happens to a certain degree. But as Patrisse says, the deindustrialization of this country, and we talk about NAFTA and everything else, it lost manufacturing jobs and the impact it had on white communities as well. But also different ways in which the deindustrialization of this country has impacted those communities of desperate communities. They have led to an informal economy because there's no space in the formal economy for them. They've been, as you know, when the cotton picking machine was invented in 1944, 100% was picked by hand. By 1970, 100% was picked by machine. That displaced a whole bunch of black people who began to make the great migrations and everything else. So I think we have to understand that we have to find programs wherever the intersection is, whether it's in Baltimore, whether it's in Oakland, where the numbers are just as drastic, or wherever they are. So we have to find ways and programs that design that come from us, that come from us, where it is a process of healing. It is a process of healing between us. It's a talking about love between us, in the sense. And I don't know, there's a program, Fania Davis has a program that she runs in Oakland called ROY, Restorative Justice for Oakland Youth. And you see young men who are going through it, and young women who are going through there and everything. And there's several other programs of restorative justice, the idea of restorative justice, you know, that is happening. But men and women are talking about that and healing, going through a process of healing. That's what it's going to take. It's going to take place in a massive place, but we have a massive scale, but we have to trust in that. We have to trust in that. I mean, the objective conditions, how do we change we change the objective conditions by, you know, walking up to the White House. We check the objective conditions by getting the kind of legislation that created jobs. When I worked for the Office of Community Development, you knew there were going to be a number of summer jobs that were going to be out of the Baby Hunters Point and the Mission District, the black and Hispanic community. You knew that and everything else. There was that you could count on 40 years ago, 45 years ago when I worked there. But the idea now is that we have to find ways in which, where we at the same time do our work, as everyone has said, do our work in our community, with our young people, around restorative justice, around healing. At the same time, we're kicking down doors at the White House, and we're kicking down doors at congressmen, and we're making demands on power. That we have to do both of those things simultaneously. And that is a radical concept. That is. It seems benign, but it's a radical concept. In a sense, that means that radical concept means that we have to take responsibility for both of those things.
I want to also hold up the important and legitimate distinction between being murdered by a neighbor and being murdered by your government.
Yeah.
Both are tragedies, but they are not the same.
Yeah.
And I think we need to be sophisticated enough to hold both in our minds, to recognize that every death, every act of violence is something that we need to fight against and address. It is also quite different when it's our government that is killing us.
And
we ought to be able to think about both things.
Another thing, I listen to Soul Talent Black, and I was listening to a song that's come on several times. Brothers gonna work it out. And I'm saying, look how positive, brothers, whatever you say, brothers gonna work it out. They think brothers gonna work it out. And I said, boy, this is 30, 40 years ago, but that brothers gonna work it out. We gotta work it out. You know, we got all of us, each step of that way.
Amen, brothers and sisters.
First and foremost, I just want to say that the young lady that asked a question about people in technology and how to do it, platform.org. Platform.org is a great organization. We're really trying to increase the innovation and the interest, participation, and success of black folks in the technology arena. So, economy, I should say. The question that I had, though, was I'm one of those people who, like you, gets upset when I watch television. I see the images that are portrayed on television. I think within the last year, I forget exactly when it was, but there was a show called Sorority Girls, or whatever that was online. Sorority Sisters, I apologize. But the idea is that we, many of the Divine Nine, came up and said, hey, listen, we're just not going to stand for that. We're not going to stand for the betrayal of our people in that particular fashion. Okay? Where is that kind of advocacy for all the other types of programs that are out there that have nothing to do with the Divine Nine. Okay, why are we not doing those things? What can we do to create the same kind of, drive to get rid of that type of programming like we did with Sorority Girls or Sorority Sisters, whatever it is, it doesn't matter.
So let's hold on to that one, which the question was, that how can we have essentially a rapid response system to address all sorts of the good, the bad, and the ugly. I want to take the remaining questions, and then I'm going to ask the panel to respond to as many as you can, because we're going to run out of time, and I know some folks have been waiting a long time. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Mario. I'm one of the types of sick too. And just coming back from Cuba, learning about how community organizing has kept that revolution intact. I want to know how black students, particularly young people, how can we better organize and mobilize ourselves on college campuses to contribute to the movement? Because we can philosophize about black liberation all day long, but we need action, and to defend our ideas, we need to organize. So that's my question.
Great. So rapid response, organizing on campuses, and you have the last question.
So my name is Michelle Greer, and I have kind of the opposite question. So I'm a first-generation college student, and I grew up in a home that was supported by government assistance. So how do you get the message to people who are worried about where their children's next meal is going to come from, like who are not in these educated settings, not in the ivory towers, as they say? Like, how do you get the message to them when they're worried about other things?
Great, thank you. So in some ways, those questions are all about organizing. So you all should jump in.
Well, I'd love to talk more about the possibility of starting a chapter on your campus. There's a few campuses that started Black Lives Matter chapters, and really they started them sort of in response to Black Student Union that wasn't doing a lot of political work, and sort of turned into a social club, and so wanted to have something more radical on campus for Black students to relate to. And so there's a Black Lives Matter chapter on Kalamazoo's campus, and a Black Lives Matter chapter on Rutgers campus. So we can talk more about that, but I do think it's about organizing, and it's about organizing through some sort of organization, and then organizing your oftentimes student unions. There's been a lot of great work with black students, like taking over the student unions and having like a long-term plan, and that's totally possible. And then I think for your question in particular, like how do we get black folks on the margin, essentially, and that's also organizing. Twitter can only go so far, right? We should not rely on our Twitter followers as that's going to take us to the next phase in this work. We should be door knocking. We should be on street corners. We should be in front of jails. We should be meeting people, real life human beings. We exist still. And I think that you know, that's an art, the art of organ. That's how I was trained. I was trained by door knocking. I was trained by talking to people on buses, going to laundromats. That work is very critical. And it also makes, when you go to people where they're at, it makes them feel like they can be a part of something. We should not expect people, exactly, we should not expect people to show up to us. We should be showing up to our people. I think you asked the same question that you asked before, which is, how do we respond? Maybe you don't believe us, but Black Twitter is it really has, intervened in some, I mean, we don't have statistics or anything for you. I don't know where you went.
Right here.
Oh.
But it doesn't appear to be working for those other shows. That one
sorority,
show.
Sorority, sorority. That was Twitter. It was on Twitter. They talked about sorority sisters on Twitter. It was a trending topic. They said get rid of it. They watched it. And Divine and I were included on Twitter talking about it. But it really does. Are you on it?
Am I on what?
Twitter.
Absolutely.
Are you on it? Are you like plugged in, followed?
Yeah, absolutely.
Then you see it.
I see it. I'm not talking about just that one show. I'm talking about shows that depict us in ways that we don't want to be depicted, ways that are negative for the rest of our community.
Yeah. Okay.
I want to make sure everybody's voice is.
You go ahead, and then let's see if we can hit everybody's question that was asked.
If a show is entertaining to people, it's Black people watching reality shows, it's white people watching reality shows, if that show is entertaining and it's making money, and people like it, which people seem to like it, that it's a franchise series, it won't go anywhere. I think we need to focus more on, again, creating the balance. Because those shows have a right to exist. Mona Scott Young is creating shows, and she has a right to. She's getting paid. But what else is there? And I think that's what we need to focus on. You know, they're trashy white people reality shows, but they have a plethora of other shows as well. And I think we're the only culture that deals with the burden of assumption. But we have to create more, we have to support more. And I will say that Color of Change, in addition to Black Twitter, Color of Change stopped the show, the production of a show called All My Baby's Mamas. It was about a rapper named Shorty Lo, who had how many kids by how many different babies' mothers? Like 33 kids.
Oh, my baby.
And honestly, gentlemen, when I created that show.
All right, settle down.
Oxygen was about to create that show, and Color of Change said, no, you're not, and mobilized and made sure that show never saw the light of day. Yeah, there are tons of things that are shut down, and I think that you know, it's part social media, and it's part advocacy and organizing as well. But I think it's definitely
for sure.
And I would add, I mean, Color Change also helped to get Cops, the show Cops, canceled. We've partnered with them as a research engine so that they actually have data to bring to networks and to use in their activism. That show Cops has probably done more harm to both black depictions of black folks and to increase stereotypes and to legitimize outrageous law enforcement behavior. So we are reaching the end. I'm going to just see if the other panelists have one each of the panelists have one final word you'd like to share with folks, and then we're going to wrap. It could be three words.
Sister's gonna work it out.
This is what we do at every action, every sit-in. We did this in the Oval Office when our folks met with Obama, so I'm not going to have everybody rise. If you are able to, if you're not able to, please stay seated. And this is from our beloved Asada Shakur, who we pray every day stays protected from this government.
It's just a repeat after me. It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to win.
It is our duty to win.
We must love and support one another.
We must love and support one another.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to win.
It is our duty to win.
We must love each other and support each other.
We must love each other and support each other.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to fight for our freedom.
It is our duty to win.
It is our duty to win.
We must love each other and support each other.
We must love each other and support each other.
We have nothing to lose but our chains.
We have